Welcome to this week's edition of Understanding Scripture with Father Dave. Father Dave Nuss is a priest of the Diocese of Toledo, a graduate of Marquette University, Mount St. Mary's Seminary, and the Catholic University of America. Father Dave examines readings that will be heard at this Sunday's Mass to help listeners better understand the Scriptures.
Hi, this is Father Dave. Thanks for listening. I so deeply appreciate you spending time with me as together we listen to God's Holy Word as it will be proclaimed for us this Sunday at Mass, the 11th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Friends, how marvelous it is that Scripture is front and center in our praise and worship of God every single week. No less than four different biblical selections are given to us every single time we gather for Holy Mass on the weekend. How privileged we are for the centrality of Scripture to be prominent in our worship of God and to benefit from God's Word time and again. It's the great God who so deeply desires to reveal Himself so that He might be present as a driving force in our daily experience. Be not afraid to ask the Lord to speak to you in exactly the way that you most need to hear His Word and to be influenced by it. This Sunday, the 11th Sunday in Ordinary Time, we will hear from the Old Testament book of the prophet Ezekiel, from the Old Testament book of Psalms, from the New Testament second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, and from the New Testament Gospel according to St. Mark. Ezekiel is the third of the three major prophets of the Old Testament. Keep in mind, major prophet doesn't refer to size in terms of the tallest or the largest or the strongest. It doesn't refer to scope of influence or more important. Rather, it's a title that recognizes the individual scrolls or parchments that are found for Isaiah, for Jeremiah, for Ezekiel, and for Daniel. In contrast, the grouping of the minor prophets and their writings are contained in a single scroll or parchment. Ezekiel is younger than Jeremiah, although a contemporary of Jeremiah, and clearly influenced by Jeremiah. We know in the beginning of Ezekiel's book that he is a priest and shortly thereafter identified as a prophet of the exile, that he, Ezekiel, writes from exile, and he's writing for those who are with him in exile, those who have been displaced from their own native land and forcibly removed, pining to return. It's to God's people in this location that Ezekiel is inspired by the Holy Spirit to communicate God's message. Ezekiel himself was among the very first grouping of Israel to be deported to Babylon in 597 BC. In exile, the people of God are faced with a great choice: to choose illusions or to choose reality regarding their salvation. Now that may sound simple, but those illusions can be very appealing, particularly when you're displaced from homeland, from family, from security. Temptations can become much more alluring as vulnerabilities increase. And Ezekiel is seized by the Spirit of God to boldly proclaim the truth, not to choose the illusions of the foreign pagan culture, but rather to remain steadfast in the hard reality they faced with eyes upon the one true God, and trusting that restoration will be God's great gift to God's people. In the first reading for this Sunday, taken from the 17th chapter of the book of the prophet Ezekiel, the prophet describes how through the very power and presence of Almighty God, that the delicate sprig or twig of God's people grows into the mightiest of trees, so that even the birds of heaven can make their nests within it. That is, from the most unassuming and unimpressive beginnings, God's glory stands to radiate profoundly. Why is that? Well, the prophet reminds us that God's power has no equal, and all we need to do is to humbly surrender to the majesty and the sovereignty of Almighty God. This enables it to be effective in the most astonishing of ways within us. Effectively, the call of the prophet that we will hear this Sunday is to let God be God. Let's listen attentively to the first reading for Mass this Sunday, the 11th Sunday in Ordinary Time, from the book of the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 17, verses 22 to 24. Ezekiel 17, beginning with verse 22. Thus says the Lord, I too will take from the crest of the cedar, from its topmost branches, tear off a tender shoot and plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain heights of Israel, I will plant it. It shall put forth branches and bear fruit and become a majestic cedar. Birds of every kind shall dwell beneath it, every winged thing in the shade of its boughs. And all the trees of the field shall know that I, the Lord, bring low the high tree, lift high the lowly tree, wither up the green tree, and make the withered tree bloom. As I, the Lord, have spoken, so will I do. God promises to take but the smallest portion and to allow it to become great. Friends, the key lies with our humble self-surrender to God. Whatever the challenge or obstacle, however formidable it is in your own life, don't be afraid to ask God to bring forth the life and the love that you're craving to experience. There is no equal force to the one true God who brings forth in our own lives an extraordinary fruitfulness. Keep in mind the setting for the prophet Ezekiel. There was not a lot of hope that was being bantered about with the exiles. And God expressly is speaking to those who find themselves, who find yourselves displaced, unsure, afraid, fractured, broken, ill, in need of healing. Gosh, that's me. That's you. That's all of us. Speaking to us exactly where we are. Let his life pour in to your own. Friends, let's turn our attention now to the second reading for Mass this Sunday. This is taken from St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. This book by St. Paul is marvelously personal. It provides us with considerable insights into his character and the deep affection that he held for the Christians in Corinth, a community he founded many years previously. This letter, his second letter to the Corinthians, is authored perhaps 6 to 8 years after his first letter. And in it, he seeks to address specific problems that have been raised by the community of faith, while also providing thoughtful consideration of the meaning of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection. Let us listen attentively to the second reading for Mass this Sunday, from St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 5, verses 6 to 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning with verse 6. Brothers and sisters, we are always courageous, although we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yet we are courageous, and we would rather leave the body and go home to the Lord. Therefore, we aspire to please Him, whether we are at home or away. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense according to what he did in the body, whether good or evil. There's a courage that the Christian disciple experiences which is not of his or her own generation. It's divine grace that is present and influencing ordinary experience. And that courage enables the Christian disciple and the community of disciples to walk by faith, not by sight, hearkening the great story with Thomas and the resurrected Lord. That faith is walking where we cannot see, but doing it with confidence in the provisions of the Lord. It's not figuring everything out and then somehow declaring, well, I have faith because I know exactly what's happening. But it's leaning into the Lord and allowing the Lord to guide, to direct, and to lead. That's a gift that I find I have to ask to receive more of in prayer. To walk by faith. Assurances of faith. Trusting in the Lord to fulfill His word through His church. Let's turn our attention now to the gospel reading for this Sunday. From the fourth chapter of Mark's gospel, Jesus is going to share with us two parables. They're actually towards the end of an extended discourse of storytelling Jesus is engaged with doing in this chapter. In the gospel reading for Sunday, these two parables that we will hear describe the kingdom of God. And in particular, they draw emphasis towards the growth of the kingdom of God. Each story has its own particular purpose. The first parable emphasizes the seed's own growth, that it grows and how it grows. The farmer can neither give the seed the power to grow any more than the farmer can make its gradual growth happen. Plant it? Yes. Care for it? Yes. But the growth itself comes forth from the seed. The second story that Jesus tells emphasizes the astonishing fruitful character of a seed. It hearkens the image that were given from the prophet Ezekiel of an abundance of life, birds from heaven making their nest in this newfound life that comes forth from a single twig or sprig. Let's listen attentively now to the reading for this Sunday from Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, verses 26 to 34. Mark 4, beginning with verse 26. Jesus said to the crowds, "This is how it is with the kingdom of God. It is as if a man were to scatter seed on the land and would sleep and rise night and day, and through it all, the seed would sprout and grow. He knows not how. Of its own accord, the land yields fruit, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. And when the grain is ripe, he wields the sickle at once, for the harvest has come." He said, "To what shall we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable can we use for it? It is like a mustard seed that when it is sown in the ground, it is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. But once it is sown, it springs up and becomes the largest of plants, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the sky can dwell in its shade. With many such parables he spoke the word to them as they were able to understand it. Without parables he did not speak to them, but to his own disciples he explained everything in private. Let's consider for a moment what happened. The Lord Jesus selects a handful of men to begin the work of proclaiming his gospel, to begin the word of spreading the good news, to begin the work of evangelization. And what about these men who were called hard-working laborers, fishermen principally, without formal education, without a large sphere of influence, without the power of persuasion in terms of eloquence? In fact, their impressive qualities are not seen because the gospel story accents all of their shortcomings and limitations. And of course, they're impoverished. They don't have a vast collection of material resources. That's not why the Lord calls them. What does he do? The weak in the world are called. They're made strong. And they come to shame those who are filled with excesses of their own selves. From a purely human point of view, they should have failed miserably time and again. It was an impossible challenge. We cannot explain from a worldly point of view how the teachings of Jesus Christ were preserved and perpetuated by this small, unimpressive from a worldly point of view, group of leaders who were assembled by Christ Jesus the Lord. And not only were they preserved and promulgated, but the whole world knew something of Jesus Christ in a very short period of time. Membership in his church was experienced in different lands and different nations and different cultures very, very quickly. Despite all of the challenges and difficulties and obstacles that were directly in the way. Well, in the parable for this Sunday, our Lord is urging all of us to be steadfast in our trust of him. This is how it is with the kingdom of God. This is how God's kingdom works. It grows silently and steadily. That so long as it's given an opportunity, it cannot be contained. We have to give it that opportunity in our own minds and in our own hearts, in our own community of faith, our parishes, our Catholic schools, our other venerable Catholic institutions, to desire to see God's kingdom advancing exactly where we are. First and foremost, above all other things. See, it's about hatching disciples. It's not about number of registered parishioners or the proliferation of all sorts of activities, however noble they may be. It is about creating disciples, making disciples, and empowering the followers of Jesus Christ to spread the good news. As long as we're sincerely seeking to do that, God's kingdom will grow. It's not our doing as much as it is our letting it be done to us. It's Marian. Lord, let it be done according to your word. That presupposes that we hear the word that is spoken in the cacophony of noises that constantly surround us. Do we hear God's word? Do we hear it clearly? Do we take it to heart enthusiastically and wholeheartedly? And then in the second part of the parable for this Sunday, to what shall we compare the kingdom of God? Jesus asks. What parable can we use for it? It is like the mustard seed The mustard seed? Are you kidding me? That's the smallest of seeds. This is God's kingdom, after all, that we're talking about. Mustard seed. Once it is sown, it springs up and becomes the largest of plants. The largest of plants, teeming with life, that God takes the smallest opening when we invite him in, and absolutely multiplies it. It's so easy to be discouraged with the challenges that we face day in and day out. Sometimes it's as if our prayers seemingly are not heard. Other times we feel very alone and isolated, and even from the church herself. Friends, I want you to take the word of Jesus to heart this Sunday and to allow the kingdom of God and all of its power to be experienced within you, to be experienced within your parish community. Don't be afraid. Jesus is working so hard in these parables to give us confidence in trusting him. He's seeking points of contact in our everyday of life, trying to elicit within us wonder and awe about the kingdom of God that is here and now. Jesus' own preaching meets with opposition. My goodness, this is the fourth chapter of Mark, and we've already seen it previously in Mark's gospel. It appears that this mission of Jesus to bring the kingdom of God is not meeting with great success thus far in Mark's gospel. But what happens? Day after day after day, even though the sower of the seed sleeps, what's happening to the seed? It's growing, having sprouted. How the sower knows this? He doesn't. He just knows that it's happening. And he knows that it's happening because he can see it. That's how it works with agriculture. We watch and wonder in awe of the increase in crops. Well, let us be sensitive towards the signs of God's kingdom growing within us. Maybe we experience it in an increasing confidence. Yes, the steps are small. Maybe we notice a deepening sense of gratitude, less edgy, irritable, impatient, judgmental, not freed from it altogether. But some of those features have less hold over us. Maybe we notice in a desire to connect with others, to share the faith with others, to discuss God's word and God's action in our daily living. Whatever it may be, know that day after day after day, it's God's great desire for his presence and power to be more prominent in all of our lives. The growth of God's kingdom, it is seen measurably. Differences are made. Hearts are touched. One thing that we can be certain in these two parables, God's going to surprise us. The world says you got to have it all figured out. Well, that's not faith. God says, trust me. I love you. You're made in my divine image. I want your fulfillment even more than you do, which is to be in comfortable relationship with me. God will surprise us. We don't know what day that seed sprouts. We know that it will. So too is it true with us. From the very smallest of beginnings, great things will come. The silent, even stealth action of God, it will bear fruit. Fruit that will be impressive. The stories that Jesus tells us this Sunday, the 11th Sunday in ordinary time, they encourage us to give God permission to be God, to allow God to work in our lives, to let him be Lord, Savior, and Messiah, not a trophy on a shelf, but a real Lord, Savior, Messiah that we need, without whom there is no hope. And to let God work in mysterious and real ways, even surprising ways. I mean, what difference would it be if we began every day asking for God to surprise us and expecting to experience the surprise before the end of the day? What a difference it would be, and can be, and is meant to be. And we can be sure that come harvest time, God will reap good fruits, because he's been about growing the crop. They'll come, and they'll be impressive. The silent, stealthy, steady working of God is still very much present in our day and age. Let's pray. O God, strength of those who hope in you, graciously hear our pleas, and sense without you, mortal frailty can do nothing. Grant us always the help of your grace, that in following your commands, we may please you by our resolve and in our deeds. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, may it come upon you and your family and your parish family, now and forever. Amen. I hope to see you at Mass.
Thank you for listening to Understanding Scripture with Father Dave, produced by Annunciation Radio. Listen again next time as Father Dave Nuss again reviews and explains the readings from Sunday's Mass.